My name is Dani Deahl, and we're here on the first day of Lollapalooza in Grant Park, Chicago. Well, as somebody who's an electronic artist, my favorite year was the year that Daft Punk played, which I think was maybe 4 years ago, but the energy that was in the crowd, the visual epicness of their LED pyramid, everything just came together in this one moment, and the sea of people was just lost in what was going on. It was amazing. Well, it's really interesting. I have a unique perspective on this because I've actually interviewed Perry twice myself for URB magazine, and that was a big topic that we've talked about for 2 years in a row, because there are a lot of people that are naysayers and think that the festival should be kept strictly rock, should keep to its roots. And Perry is very much an avid electronic music fan, is producing it himself, collaborating with a lot of great artists. And for me, it's not that Lollapalooza is a rock festival, it's a contemporary festival, and it's taking in whatever the modern influences are that are going on in the world. And you're finding there's a lot of crossover. The people that are going to listen to Eminem might go over and listen to deadmau5. I got a little bump this year. It's amazing. I got a fantastic slot, 7:30 p.m. on the PlayStation stage, and we're going beyond a typical DJ set this year. We have an entire video intro that we filmed and choreographed with my dancers, and I made custom audio for that. We have choreographed pieces for several of the songs I'm going to play during my set, stage props. It's beyond just having go-go dancers during a set. It's more mimicking a traditional pop setup, but for a DJ set. The people that really influenced me when I first got into electronic music were the house staples in Chicago. I mean, I started going to raves when I was in high school. The people I was listening to were Mark Almeria, Paul Johnson, Acetate, Craig Alexander, all of these guys that built what the city is known for today. Rick Garcia, you know, I love them. I still listen to these guys. I learned producing just by hanging out with friends, with other people that produce. It's the same way I learned DJing, was just going and watching other people and then trying it for myself for a few months and screwing up continuously until I got it right. I mean, a lot of people go to school for it now, but I learned tricks from friends who had learned those tricks from other friends, and there was a lineage of all of these little production techniques that trickled down. You know, what I normally tell people, because a lot of people say, well, it's because you're a female DJ, and for me it was, I never focused on that at all. I just wanted to be the best DJ that I possibly could be, and I'm very technically minded during my sets as it is. So it's being very proud of my craft and treating it like a craft, something that I spend a lot of time in every day, even though I've been doing it for 10 years, treating it like a career, like a job. People ask me, well, you know, if you're a DJ, you work at night, but you must do nothing during the day, so what do you do with your days? I'm like, really? I market myself during the day, you know? I write my blog, I'm on my social media networks, I'm producing music, you know, I'm sending promos out. I'm working during the day and at night, all the time. Because there are way less of us. There are way less of us. And the female DJs that are out there tend to fall into two categories. They're the ones that dress tomboyish, that tried really hard to not posit themselves as a female artist, and then you get the ones that are the Playboy DJs, the ones that spin topless, whatever, and they use it as their shtick, right? It's very hard to find female DJs. They're just comfortable with being a girl, and they choose to dress feminine, but it doesn't define them as an artist. And that's how I've chosen to approach it, and it took me a long time to become comfortable with that. Even, I mean, I used to just dress in t-shirts and jeans because I didn't want people to perceive me that way. And I finally got to the point where I can say, you know what, I'm going to dress how I feel comfortable, how I feel best expresses myself, and however people want to perceive it, that's how they want to perceive it. I would say, first and foremost, before you even think about marketing yourself, before you think about putting yourself out there as a female DJ, learn the basics. I see so many artists right now, whether they're male or female, just DJs starting out, that learn in programs that do most of the work for them. And I've found that if you master the basics, the mixing, how to listen to measures, keys, then it gives you the freedom later on to experiment and to get a little crazier in your sets. But if you let a program do all of the work for you and you don't really know the fundamentals of what's going on, then you become very restricted. So for girls that are starting out, if you make sure that you learn those technical aspects, it will give you the creative freedom to be a better DJ. And ultimately, that's what makes people respect you.